I did. I called him and I said, here's a date. It was less than a week away. And I said, going down here to the San Diego Skydiving School and do it there. And he says, okay. And so I went down there expecting to see Laz. His name was Jim Laslovic. Jim was a former football player for the Chargers and the Detroit Lions. He didn't show. I looked around and he sent a cameraman and two reporters. They took all kinds of pictures and talked to me, and I didn't realize what they were doing. And I found out that NBC had put that on the news, and it was all over the damn country. The next morning, I was out pouring myself a cup of coffee, and a phone rang, and it was a nephew that I had up in Fairbanks, Alaska. And he says, Uncle Dean, he says, I just saw you on TV. I said, you did? He said, yeah, you were jumping out of an airplane. And I said, oh, God, I didn't know that. I had another call from a friend in Florida, and he'd seen it on TV. So I got pretty good coverage on that. And of course, everybody that I knew in the San Diego area, Coronado, where I lived, had seen it, and down at the golf course, where I spent a lot of my time. And a whole bunch of these guys came up and said, my God, Diz, we saw you on TV, and you were jumping out of a plane. Are you crazy? And I said, no. I said, in fact, I said, I kind of was the truth a little bit. I said, I've made arrangements for my 100th birthday. I'm going to go again. And all these guys said, by golly, we're going to go with you. You know, and a whole bunch of them.
You're committed now.
And my birthday a couple of years ago, or it was first this year, my daughter put a piece of paper up on the board and said, tell them I was going to go on my 100th birthday and go skydiving, and anybody wants to go with them, sign below. And I got about 40 guys that signed up to go. So, but I know darn well they most of them didn't mean it, because they probably don't think I'll live to be 100.
So. You'll
look great. And so we're pulling for you.
I have two questions for
please.
You.
All right.
Just two. What position did your dad play in baseball?
He was a first baseman.
Okay. And how many nieces and nephews do you have?
Oh.
Quite a few, huh?
Yes, especially on my wife's side.
Oh, right.
She came from a quite large family. There were 10 children in her family. And they weren't all as prolific as her parents, but even a few, when you get 10 and they multiply and go on, you end up with quite a few relatives.
That's true.
And they're... It's a great family. I told most of them about what I did growing up. I went to school, graduated school. I worked every summer in the fruit industry. But during the school year, I worked in a gas station. And I was working in the gas station when the first credit cards came out. And for those days, you had to write everything out on the cards, you know, and license plate and the number of the credit card and the guy's name and all that stuff. And then take it out and hand it to him and he'd sign it. That was it. Well, we had, as I say, credit cards first came out, this is back in the late 30s. And in my spare time, I was reading, I made up a list of all these guys, and I memorized all of their credit card numbers. So I didn't have to ask them the card every time. I had to tell them, do mine, I know what it is, I'd buy it, I'd write up the card. Came out in 41, May of 41, I was just graduating from Placer Junior College, and I was working in the gas station. And one of my principal customers came in and made out his credit card and took it out to him. And this guy was the manager of one of the big food shipping sheds in Loomis, Pacific Fruit Exchange. And he said, what are you doing? Where are you going to work this summer? I said, oh, I'll probably go down to America. I've been working for Bob Larson down there for about 5 years every summer. He says, how about coming to work for me? And I said, well, I'd have to let Bob know, because I don't know if he's really counting on me or not, but he's been a good boss for 5 years. And he said, he says, I want you for a better job than what you've been getting before. He said, I want you to be my tallyman, which was first job under him. It was a pretty responsible job. You had to keep track of every box of fruit that came in, and you'd have maybe 1,000 to 1,500 boxes of fruit every day. And they would be put in the different refrigerated cars. And the cars held, up to about 1,000 to 1,200 boxes of fruit. You had to keep track of each farmer, each box, number of the kind of fruit it was, the size it was, and so on. And write all this stuff down. He said, I want you to be my tallyman. And I guess he was impressed that I could keep track of numbers pretty well. And he says, I'll pay you $135 a month. Well, that's standard rate for a tallyman in town, and all the other fruit sheds, and his too at that time, was $125 a month. And he said, I'll pay you $135 if you'll come to work for me. He said, but you got to promise you won't tell anybody. He says, these other managers find out I'm giving you $135, he says, I'll be in deep trouble. So I went to work for him. And getting close to the end of the season, the pears being the last fruit we shipped, pears were slowing down, and we had a fruit inspector that inspected all of the fruit that went through our shed. He said to me one day, Dean, he says, what are you going to do when the fruit runs out? And I said, God, I don't know. I said, I want to go back to school, but I don't have enough money saved up to move down to Berkeley and pay tuition and buy books and all that and have a place to sleep. And he said, well, he said, I've been watching you. And he said, how would you like to be an inspector? And I said, Oh, I don't know. It never occurred to me. And I was 20 years old this time. And he said, well, I think you can do a good job. He said, I'm going up to Auburn to see my boss tomorrow. He said, I'll tell him about you and see what he says. So he came back and he told me, he says, my boss wants to talk to you. So I went up to see him, and so they hired me. And I got another raise, got $150 a month. But then, it wasn't very much longer, about 3 months later, the Japanese had bombed Pearl Harbor, and I knew I wanted to fly. I already had a pilot's license. I'd gotten that in my last semester I was in. I got it in February of 41. And I used to fly quite a bit. I'd go around to kids that I knew and say that I knew they hadn't ever flown in an airplane on, and I would say, how'd you like to go for a ride? And, oh, yeah. I said, well, you know, it cost me $7 an hour to rent the airplane. And if you pay $350 on it, I'll pay $350, and we'll both get an hour's ride. And I got a lot of them that did that. So I was able to build up quite a bit of flight time before the war started. And I joined about a week after Pearl Harbor. I was going to join the Army Air Corps. I had papers out and everything when my brother and I both were going. And I had an old friend came down and see me, and he says, Dean, he says, we gotta sign up. And I said, I know. I'm planning on joining the Air Force, the Air Corps. And he says, I want to join too. He said, but I'm thinking about joining the Navy. And I said, why? And he said, I don't think the Navy's airplanes are as hard to fly or as fast and as maneuverable as the Air Force planes. He says, I have a bad heart. And he did. In school, I made him quit athletics. He'd pass out just walking down the street. And I said, well, he said, I think I can handle the Navy airplanes. And I said, well, that's interesting. And I'll give it a thought. He said, well, I've got to go back. He was up at Donner Summit. He had worked up there. And he said, I got to go back up on the hill. And he said, I got to go over to Reno as well. And I got a friend over there that's a druggist. And he gives me this heart medicine that I have to take every day. And he said, I got to go up and get a new bottle of heart medicine. And he said, I'll be back on Thursday. This was a Sunday. And he said, we'll go down to San Francisco and join up. And I said, okay. Well, I waited until Thursday and he didn't show up. So, and I'd gotten to thinking about the Navy and boy, I bet that'd be a lot of fun flying off of aircraft carriers. And so I had jumped in my dad's car and I drove down San Francisco and I joined. And he showed up a couple of days, I got home, showed up a couple of days later and he says, okay, I'm ready to go. And I said, oh, I've already been.
So you were signed up at that point?
Yeah.
You'd already signed up. Okay, well that's a good point for us to break. You have made your transition from civilian to military life, is that correct?
Yeah, I joined, I think it was the 19th of December. And they asked me, when do you want to start flying? I said, tomorrow. They said, well, our first class is January.